So we're going to continue on with Dr. Bob Konzemius. We'll just do a little intro here. Bob Konzemius earned a BA in chemistry at St. John's University, Minnesota. He has a master's in science in meteorology at MIT in 1990, and a PhD in meteorology at the University of Oklahoma in 2004. Since 2005, he has been employed at WindLogix, where he works as a senior scientist at their science center in Grand Rapids, Minnesota. His research is focused on flow through wind farms, complex terrain, and turbine wakes. His research interests also extend into mesoscale meteorology, where he has worked on numerical simulations of mesoscale convective vortices. During his PhD, he participated in IHOP 2002 field experiment, which studied, among other things, the initiation of convective storms, and ROTIC, which is Radar Observations of Tornadoes Experiment in 2001 and 2003. So please give a big warm welcome to Dr. Bob Konzemius.
Well, thank you. As amazing as that, well, I don't know if I should, this was more normal things to list out all those qualifications, and you expect me to be a great storm researcher or something. Actually, for me, storm chasing has always been more of a hobby, and I've done these sorts of things on the side, aside from my main goal, career job. And so when I got invited to the present speak here, I thought, well, gosh, you know, I've got other people speaking that are really going out there a lot, storm chasing, Reed being the keynote speaker, having a very close perspective of a lot of tornadoes. And I'm like, and I'm kind of looking back on a lot of my chasing from the past couple of years anyhow, and I'm thinking, you know, I have all these, I've seen tornadoes, but it seems like they've been 20 miles away, so that's half the perspective of my talk. And the other one is, and I'm sure some of you can probably relate to that, the other one is 20 years of storm chasing history. I started out about 20 years ago, but this is actually my first tornado, and I wasn't recognized as I was seeing it. 25, almost 26 years ago this year, was that helicopter video, and there's the guy. Yeah, so that was my first tornado. I wasn't actually chasing it. I just happened to be driving through, and I had a camera in my back seat of my car and didn't even ever think to take a picture of it. So I have no documentation of actually having been there, but believe me, a million people saw that. It was a really visible tornado. I kind of started out, in, this is out in Colorado, I was living at the time in 1992, Pawnee National Grassland in northeastern Colorado. We do this, some coworkers and I would just sort of casually go out, and I had some friends of mine that I got my master's degree with at MIT, and they happened to be visiting out at NCAR. And we'd go out, and first time we went out, first we found hail. No tornado, but in those days we were really excited to see a thunderstorm, I guess. And this is my 1992 Honda Civic, which at that time, this is 1992, so you can say it's a brand new car. And you'll see it again later. But that's basically the time the storm chasing started in my lifetime. And I'll leave you. This is Scott Wong here. I got a brief video clip of him, and I guess I'm going to have to mouse click on this to start the video rolling. Here, mouse, where are you?
There we are. Our action area now is probably shifting over to the east. So we're going to head east and then probably north to try to stay with this storm.
And just as quickly as it struck, it was gone.
So there is your brief introduction to Minnesota's storm chasing history that, among others, there's Sean Kelly in there too, and Mike. Langfus and Dave Floyd were also involved. You'll see them later on here. But Scott still basically looks the same. He wears a similar colored shorts. And yeah, he's really good with storm videos and narration and such. What's really happened over the past 20 years? I guess the number one thing that would be first to stand out in your brain would be a lot more chasers nowadays. And why is that? Well, there's been a lot of stuff that's happened over the past 20 years, has made it a lot more accessible to a lot of people where it wasn't before. Internet, Twister, a lot of people blame Twister the movie, but there's a lot of other stuff that's going on. Some of it just spreads word by word of mouth, but there's been over really a lot of technological improvements that really makes this an exciting field today where it wasn't before. You know, you can go back to the early 1990s where the internet was available at universities, basically, and at computer companies. And in the early 90s, you could dial up and hook up with, like, say, maybe a 1200 baud modem, and that's just so, you know, slow compared to nowadays. So you've got I had my first dial-up in 1994, and then by today, I've got a 25 megabit per second connection to my house, and that's, you know, do the math here, this is like 0.014 compared to 25, so that's just more over 1,000 times faster. And so imagine in those days, you can say, well, let's get a satellite picture. You go down, sit down, have a cup of coffee, come back later, or maybe brew a cup of coffee, cook yourself breakfast, and then at the end of that, the satellite picture was downloaded. But now it's like you can get it in just like a split second. Well, this is Twister. It's credited with at University of Oklahoma, where I got my PhD. It's credited with having a quadrupling of undergraduate meteorology majors between about 1996, when the movie came out, and about 2003. And I came in there kind of in the middle of that and noticed, like, every year there seemed to be a larger group of undergraduates coming in there. And at the time I thought, well, the movie's not very realistic. But nowadays, it sort of is. People do drive into tornadoes. So another big technology is allowing the National Weather Service to see things better than they did in the past. Is radar technology. Not all of this, the Doppler and wheels, you don't really see that in real time, however, but going from the WSR 57s back in the early 1990s that were still just kind of duct taping those radars together at the time, and upgrading to the WSR 88D and now dual polarization, now you're able to see a lot more of what's going on inside the storm, especially with the rotation, the velocities, and nowadays we're getting information on maybe precipitation types inside the storm as well. This is a WSR 57 image from May 6th, 1965, the Fridley outbreak, and you can see on these, you can see hook echoes, and that's the main way the Weather Service could detect the possibility of a tornado. You look for that hook echo. However, nowadays we have well, this is another one. This is June 16th, 1992. I happened to be in Colorado at the time, living in Colorado, and videotaped the Weather Channel. This is Mike Seidel. And right here is the storm that produced Minnesota's most recent F5 tornado in Chandler, off to the southwest, where this storm is on the radar here. But you got a combination of different radar technologies from the WSR 74s, some of which were C-band, and others WSR 57s. But for the 1998 tornado outbreak in southern Minnesota, we had the WSR 88D network in place. So that's made a big change in what the Weather Service sees. When the Weather Service sees something, they can get warnings out, and chasers, of course, with their technology can see, are getting those warnings, and they're, oh, this storm is interesting, and everybody kind of goes that way. So this has really influenced chasing in a sort of an indirect way. Then the radar technology came along further in terms of mobile radars. This is Howie Bluestein, somewhere about 1990, early 90s, towing his CW radar truck, which is a millimeter wave radar. You just really basically pointed in the direction of a tornado, and you get this return that showed you a spectrum of velocities. And you can infer from that what the maximum speed was in the tornado. The Doppler on wheels came along and rotated in 1995, and then 1997, the Dow 3 came along with a much more sophisticated truck, and this is a picture of that. It's an X-band radar. You can't see really great through storms, but it can see just far enough to get a good view of the hook, and range gates down to 20 meters, so you get really high resolution. And these are the first radar scans to really reveal the tornado genesis process in, you know, 2D or even 3D. They do 3D scans of these two. So that's been a big thing. But they're not imperfect. They're not perfect. This is Dow when I was in Rotate in 2003. You see the duct tape on the radome. We call it end of season South Dakota. This is because our season ended here as the radome imploded as we were driving down I-90 at hitting an outflow boundary. Actually, we're coming out of the outflow, going into inflow, and when the wind switched, you know, what was like, you know, the radome was sensing 40 miles per hour, and that quickly went up to, you know, 90 miles an hour or something like that. And so it imploded the radome, and then our season was done because that affects all the wave guys and all the radar equipment inside it. So that was the end of the season. 2003 was another year when this is the first time TIV came out. And this is what it looked like back then. This is May 8th. All of a sudden, this weird vehicle shows up in our parking lot with our rotate caravan. Armored type vehicles with a lot of plating. Basically, Sean Casey here just went in and started welding 50 or something. There it is. Got Dominator now, too, which is out there, too. Those are the two ones. And Reed will be talking about that just after lunch. Okay, models. What is our computer forecasting capability, you know, how has that changed? And in 1992, 20 years ago, we had models called the LFM model, which you probably never heard of. It was discontinued a long time ago. It was a limited fine mesh model. And NGM is the nested grid model. And you could tell these models had grid resolutions of 80 kilometers. And really not. So you have a grid point here in the Twin Cities. You might have one, and the next one might be as close as Mankato or something like that. So just a fairly low resolution model. But we can get enough to see larger synoptic scale features. In 1996, the ADA model came along, the next version of models, and that resolution improved to 12 kilometers by 2003. So a grid point, you know, if you imagine several grid points across the Twin Cities metro area. That's the sort of resolution we have. Really, it's operational nowadays. They've held it for reasons, technical reasons, on the parameterizations within the model. They work better at 12, and if you get down too small in the grid interval, they don't work quite so well. But they have other versions of the models that they go down to 4 kilometer high resolution versions of WRF and the high resolution rapid refresh, where you can actually look and see, you know, check for convection initiation every hour of that model run. So something I find myself doing now that that's available. So this is what those models look like 20 years ago. You get an idea. Well, that was basically, yeah, there's a low up here in Canada and there's a high down here in the U.S. This is a so-called death ridge pattern. It's the only pattern, the only example of this I had on my computer from back then. So that's what you see. Well, nowadays, this is from the WRF ARW model, which has a 4 kilometer delta X on it. And you can see, well, here's an example of the sort of lots of detail. You go along, you can probably say that there's going to be a squall line going through Florida here. That level of detail, not that that's going to be actually right, but at least you're seeing a larger set of meteorological features that's being resolved in these models. So more accurate forecasting than certainly we had before. We also have more METAR stations, more surface observation stations to tell us what's going on. Here is 17th of May, 1996, where a target area was southwestern around the Redwood Falls area. Actually, I went up in here. This is Scott. This was Scott's target area. This is out from his weather log from that year. But nowadays, you know, the maps are just filled with these observations. So you can look it up, bring it up on your favorite software to display them, or just download this UCAR map, and you'll see what's going on, temperature, dew point, over pretty high resolution. So you have a very good detailed picture of what things are like before storms develop, and that makes it pretty easier. Chaser communication has changed. The storm track, you know, this has really changed things quite a bit, in fact. The storm track was kind of a typical type of, or phone was a form of communication back in the early 90s. And it arrives in the mail. If somebody got something, you maybe called them up and say, hey, I got a tornado today, and you didn't see their images for maybe several days, or they sent you a videotape out and you get it in the mail a couple days later. But then we got email, so you can get a little bit more communication. This one I found for some reason interesting to say that he's saying, Scott Wallen is saying here that, yeah, we're talking about a storm we had chased in 96. on August 21st. He said, well, I have the recorded the Weather Channel from 5 to 10 p.m. And I got to look at what this storm looked on radar by recording the Weather Channel and looking back on my VHS tape. Nowadays, you wouldn't think about it that way. So I was like, wow, this is kind of neat. So then listserv groups came along. And then you get a bunch of people hopping on there and distributing their emails to a larger group of people. And the original purposes of those was to, for forecasting and such, to figure out, well, where is everybody thinking about going? And they eventually changed a fair bit, and a number of people started hopping onto them. And at this point, that kind of the late 90s, early 2000s, that there seemed to be a lot more people that were out there, almost career chasers, who were chasing almost every event. And so when I was trying to work on my PhD and trying to get the work on studying with my classes, I kind of had to shut this stuff off, because you get like, yeah, I saw this tornado in Kansas today. I'm going to Missouri tomorrow, and you'll see them. They're out there. Well, I got to study for my final exam. I can't do that. So I was just like, I want to be out there, but I can't. Bulletin boards came along, and now you get instant pictures from everybody. As soon as they're done from their chase that evening, they upload their pictures. But nowadays, they can upload them from their cars. So you see the pictures, of course, as it's happening. And now we have Facebook. You can look, and people are uploading camera pictures from their phones on Facebook pretty much instantly. I looked at Tim Marshall's page to get this wonderful collage of tornadoes. So this is kind of, Facebook is kind of an interesting, it's kind of interesting because there are a lot of people, I've never seen it in any other sort of friending on Facebook. There's a lot of storm chaser, I get a lot of storm chaser friend requests. And I don't know if it's like in common with everybody else too, but there's something about the storm chaser community that's unique in that. It's like you'll get a lot of requests from people you've really never met, and I don't think they know me either, but there's a friend request coming across. But I think a lot of cases I may have ignored a couple of those too, and I've actually met the person, so I'm a bit worried about that. I hate being a total dork. So if you sent me one of these along the way and I say, well, you haven't heard back, just say like, hi, I am so-and-so, I saw you, and then I'll say yeah. Okay.
Have you reached 5,000?
No, I have not. No, I don't have 5,000. I'm not reading. Okay, so nowadays, so now I have watched May 30th, 2011 was a momentous occasion for me that I watched while I was chasing, watched somebody else's live stream to see what else was going on. So the technology has come around full force. So if I'm not seeing much where I am, I can just hook up on somebody's live stream somewhere. And, oh yeah, that's a tornado that's on that next storm 40 miles south and I'm missing, dang it. And since all these different media come along, we've got the bulletin boards seem to be slowing down a fair bit. I get comments on, like, you see threads like, well, is this site dead? Yeah, so something. All right, so. Okay, so Data Community Road, I got boring bullet point part of my PowerPoint, which may have put you all to sleep, but. Okay, so this is a PC laptop. I don't know what sort of processor this has in it. Maybe the IBM 8086 processor, one of the first. This is Dave Floyd, and Mike Lankvist is in toying around with stuff in the front of the vehicle. Yes, and they're trying to hook up with a cell phone. The other thing was actually looking at the sky. I found back then, as I looked at the sky, a lot more than I do now. Now I'm looking at the computer, like, what's going on over here? What's going on over there? Like, oh yeah, we've got weather up above us too. So, got out of our car. Here's a picture of us looking out. Bob Adams and Sean Kelly's in their picture too. I'm taking the picture. We're looking at the sky. Speed of data on the road, of course, now. You're talking about 300 baud if you're lucky. And now we're talking about 3G, 4G speeds, which can get data just about as fast as your home internet connection. So. Really quite a big change. Television. Here's a television. We brought a television along with us and watched the television stations. And here's a picture from Traynor, Iowa on May 16th, 1999. Who of you had television? Have you ever chased with television yet? years. Okay, you're not supposed to do that. Yeah, I put it in the back seat so I could look at it as a passenger. Somebody else drove. This is the little small tornado we saw embedded in the rain. You can barely see it. And then we drove away from that, followed that mesocyclone to the northeast as the next mesocyclone from the southwest came along and developed a wedge that we missed. Darn. Okay, so this is the rate. This is this Honda Civic again. Now, yeah, still it's 1999, and this is the amateur radio setup with a HF communications, a couple of 2-meter antennas for Skywarn, and listening to NOAA weather radio. And this one actually doubled as a TV antenna. So you don't see that anymore. This caused car accidents because people were staring at my antennas. Okay, we have Baron ThreatNet, which is active nowadays. And now we can see, well, which of these am I going to pick? I don't know. I'm a little indecisive because I can see everything. Oh, goodness. The storm I'm on is not producing a tornado. This one down here is, so, gosh. Oh, let me go to that next storm. Oh, but it's dark. It's going to get dark before I can get there, so let me go back to my previous storm and, oh, this is what I saw. What is that? I don't know. It's either a wall cloud or a wedge.
Sounds like a wedge.
Yeah, I can't tell. Anyway, so then we have GR level 3, 2, which gives us a nice, well, there's a nice hook that can give you a little bit more resolution, and that's the tornado with Canastota, South Dakota, that we saw, which was quite nice. So, anyway, video camera technology, yes. Going from nowadays where you can live stream in HD, back now where we've got VHS, 240 lines of resolution. Vertical lines of resolution, and now we've got high def, which is four times that, basically. Busted chases. I don't think the technology has totally eliminated them, but I think it has reduced them a fair bit. All right, so what does it all mean? Basically, there's a couple of things that haven't changed. Is number one, they haven't developed a cloning technology, so you can only be in one spot at a time. You can't send your clone out and say, oh, check out this storm over here, and I'll experience either one. You can still bust a little bit, but we got faster sharing of the video and stills, and it's really kind of opened things up in the chaser community. Okay, so here's a chase from 20 years ago.
I know I'm thinking how we're doing on time. I'm going to show you 16th of June, 1992. And pay attention to a couple of things on here. What sort of technology they're using, and then how many other chasers are on the road. Oh, I'm going to bring that
tornado
right.
Tornado on the ground near just south of Tracy. And it's moving into western Redwood County. And
God, the smile
it doesn't get any better than this.
I mean, this
it doesn't get any better than this. It's got to be a large tornado.
We are in a good spot. We're definitely in flow, but just trying to get some cloud bases and trying to determine where we are. It's so hard to see. Dave's figuring out where, you know.
It's like.
Awesome.
Unless it fell apart.
It's like things should be right here. You can definitely see better cloud definition now.
We were rocked by a couple shots of golf ball size hail, serious hail, being driven by the inflow winds right into the side of the eclipse here.
Okay, so they're just going visually mostly.
Starting to see some definition on the storm.
And all you do this storm is
Bob's face. Oh my goodness! Ladies and gentlemen, time is 7:40. Large tornado on the ground. We're about 10 miles north of Labasso. Very large tornado on the ground. Strong inflow winds. Everybody at home, Styles, this is it. This is what we came out for. We had a double tornado event initially. Now we've just got one single tornado, and it is huge, kicking up dust and debris. Ladies and gentlemen, this is spectacular. Joel, everybody at home, this is a tornado. Huge tornado. We've got very strong inflow. I'm going to try to get out of the car here. Tornado, steak dinner! Very large tornado. We're losing a bit of our viewing here. We're probably going to have to go north. Steak dinner!
Scott never got excited when he sees something.
We're
over on time, but
okay, I'm just gonna just about two more images and
hit F5.
I could probably just end it right here, but I just wanted to show you some of my 20 mile away beauties. Here's 20 miles away from Glen Rose, Texas, on April 25th of this year. Fortunately, today's high contrast technology, you can bump up the contrast and see it a little bit better. This is Goodnight, Texas on 2010. Started 20 miles away, ended only 12 miles away. So this is Manoman, Minnesota. Oddly enough, this is probably, I don't know if any other chasers saw this tornado. Maybe somebody did, but it's one of those rare possible exclusives where you don't see tons of images around the internet after you've gotten it. 16 miles away. And then, of course, my most impressive catch was this one from 23 miles away, Kim, Colorado, May 30th, 2005. And that will end the talk. Thank you for listening.
All right. We have time for a question or two. Any questions?
Oh, goodness.
I guess we'll have time for one question.
I can only see like a year. I guess I'm curious. I think about all the technology, what you're going to have to buy, what's going to drain your budget as a chaser. And I'm worried about 3D technology and what we might do with that. I think our internet and stuff is just going to keep speeding up. And I don't know, I think it'll reach the set. I wonder if it'll reach a saturation point where all the people that are out there, who are out there interested in weather, are going to be out chasing and the rest just don't care. So we'll get to some, level, I think, of where this increase will not be so much anymore.
All right, thank you, Bob. Another, okay, we'll do one quick question.
What are your favorite snacks when you're out chasing?
No, well, my favorite actually happens to be powdered sugar donuts. And for the reason, on May 31st, 1999, a Sitka, Kansas tornado chase, started the morning making fun at a Budweiser commercial or Miller Lite commercial, but not nowadays. It's like the guy's eating donuts and he's just working on his shop and he's getting grease on his donut. What's a little grease on that donut? That's just flavor for a high life man, something like that. So I'm doing this talk at the beginning of the day with my powdered sugar donuts in the passenger compartment, passenger side of my car. And at the end of the day, I had put these donuts on the back shelf of my car.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. And so we're getting ahead, we're running away from the Sitka tornado because it's getting close to us. And yeah, there you see a picture of the tornado with the powdered sugar donuts as a foreground. So powdered sugar donuts.
All right, another round of applause for Bob. Thank you.